there, and welcome to Watch It Played. My name is Rodney Smith, and in this video, we're going to learn the 2-4 player Disney Jungle Cruise adventure game, designed by Prospero Hall and published by Ravensburger, who helped sponsor this video. The president of the Jungle Navigation Company is looking for experienced skippers to bring several travelers and cargoes safely through the jungle to her headquarters. Worried that you don't have any experience sailing a ship? No problem. Just put on a captain's hat, because I find most people don't ask any questions after that point. And once you've set sail, it's too late anyway. Besides, it's a jungle. What could go wrong? Join me at the table, and let's learn how to play. To set up, place the game board in the middle of the play area. Now mix up these lost and found tokens into face-down piles by the board, along with the shuffled face-down deck of navigation cards, which look like this. The pieces with this back are the outpost tokens, and they come in three different types, which you can distinguish by their art. Place one of each type face down by the spaces of the board that show these outpost tents. When you're done, you'll have a set on each of these four areas. The pieces with this back are the four clue tokens. Without looking at their other side, shuffle and place one face down by each of the locations on the board that show one of these mailboxes. You'll have one left over, which you set by the finish area known as the headquarters, and nearby also put these tip tokens with their values face up. Each player now chooses a boat placard, its matching colored mover, a warning flare token, which you'll keep flip face up to this side, and the 12 passenger tokens, which have the ship's name printed here on their back. I'll be setting up a two-player game in this video using the yellow pieces, and any unused pieces you can just return to the box. Now I'll also point out your boat has four different sections. The center, the stern, the port, and the starboard. Here's a little sailing tip for you. If you can't remember which side is the port and which is starboard, when you're facing forward in a ship, the port is always on your left side, and the words port and left have the same number of letters. So there you go. Not that you will ever need to know that when you're playing this game at all, but now you do. Each of these different sections can hold up to three tokens, and you'll start by arranging all 12 of your passengers however you like onto your boat. We'll see later why you might want to arrange them in a certain way, but for your first game, you can also just arrange them randomly. Each player is then given one of these skipper specialty cards randomly to put face up in front of themselves. In later games, you can also just set all the specialties face up on the table and let the players pick the one that they want, starting with the youngest player and going clockwise around the table. But either way, with your specialties assigned, you then return the rest of them back to the box. Finally, set the dice by the board and have all of the players put their boat movers on the starting dock location. And then the last player who told a joke is selected as the first player. And that's the setup. In the Disney Jungle Cruise adventure game, you're going to be taking passengers down a pleasant jungle river where they will all arrive safely at their destination, the company headquarters. Or at least that's what we print on the brochures. After all, this is a jungle cruise. There'll be perils around every corner. Wild animals, waterfalls, and all kinds of unexpected encounters as you try to gather cargo and get at least some of the original passengers to the headquarters at the end of the trip. Because there, the head of the company will declare which of the four families she invited to cruise that day will take over her business while she goes on vacation. Players will gain points by delivering cargo and passengers, and by being the first to arrive at the headquarters. The skipper who can manage to do this best will win. The game is played over a series of turns, starting with the first player, and then going clockwise around and around the table. And on your turn, you'll perform five steps, starting with rearranging your load. At the start of the game, your boat will already be arranged and full, but later you may have fewer passengers, some cargo, and several empty spaces. Only one passenger or cargo token may go in each space, but here you can arrange them in any way you like before continuing with the rest of your turn. Various things may affect the items on your boat, but just know anything in the center of the boat tends to be safest. The next step of your turn is to roll for speed using this die. It has values from 1 all the way to 4, with doubles of the 2 and 3 values. Now, after rolling, you then move your ship that number of spaces following this path. At the beginning of the game, you are considered to already be on this space, so getting a 3, 1, 2, 3, would put us here. there are a few special spaces on the board. Outposts that show a tent, and clues that show a mailbox, and you must always stop when you enter one of their spaces, no matter what you rolled. You'll also notice that sometimes the path will branch off in different directions, and when you come to one of those spaces, you choose which way you want to continue. So for example, if I was here and I rolled a 4, I would move one space to here, then decide which direction I wanted to go. Let's say I chose to go here, and because I've come to an outpost, I won't move any further this turn. After moving, you'll check to see what encounters you might have had on your trip. This is called navigating the river. And here, you'll reveal 4 navigation cards from the top of the deck. And you always reveal 4, no matter how many spaces you traveled. At the bottom of each one, you'll find a joke that you can read to the table. After all, a good skipper keeps everyone in good spirits. You then encounter as many cards as the number of spaces you actually moved that turn. For example, if I had rolled a 4, but only ended up moving 3 spaces because I was forced to stop at an outpost, I'd pick any 3 of these to resolve and then ignore one of them. In other words, the further you move on a turn, the more dangers you'll have to encounter, whereas if you roll a lower number, you won't move as far, but you'll have more options about which dangers you face and which ones you get to avoid. Any cards you chose not to encounter are now placed in a face-up discard pile. And while playing, if the draw deck ever runs out, just reshuffle the discard pile into a new one. But with your encounters picked, you now resolve each of them one at a time in the order that you choose. Each of these will have a danger level here, and to resolve it, you roll as many peril dice as the number of red X's you see. So in this case, I would roll 3. And for every one of these symbols you roll, you must discard one cargo or passenger token from the highlighted section of your boat that's shown in this area of the card. So this is pretty bad. I would now have to lose 3 tokens from the starboard side of my ship. However, each player has a warning flare token, and you can use this to try to scare off an encounter by flipping it over. You then get to re-roll all of the dice showing this symbol for that particular card. But once flipped, this flare cannot be used again, though we'll see a little bit later how sometimes it can be flipped back over. Either way, after re-rolling, you must keep the results of your new roll, and let's say we got this. It's a little better. Now I only have to lose 2 tokens. For this example, let's pretend it's a little later in the game and our boat looks like this. And don't worry, soon we will learn how you gain cargo like this. Now, if you decide to resolve one of these symbols by removing a passenger, place them face up next to the board. These are considered to be lost passengers that are now wandering the jungle and may be picked up again later. If you decide to use one of these symbols to remove a piece of cargo, it is lost in the jungle forever and you return it to the game box instead. It is possible that you'll roll more of these symbols than the number of tokens you have in the section of your ship that is being affected. If so, then you only lose as many tokens as you can and you ignore any extra symbols. If when resolving a card like this, the area was already empty before I even rolled the dice, well, it wouldn't matter what I rolled because I'd have nothing here to lose, which is good, technically. Either way, after resolving all the navigation cards that you encountered, they are then discarded. I should mention, after moving your boat and then drawing your 4 navigation cards, you may reveal one or more of these special navigation cards. These will have their text printed horizontally, and they must be resolved first before anything else, carrying out their text here and then discarding them. But they do count against the number of cards you resolve. For example, if these had been the 4 cards I had drawn after moving, and I had only moved 3 spaces, then first I would have to resolve both of these special events, and I could do them in either order, and then I'd pick just one of these that remain. If I had only moved 1 space, then I would just pick one of these 2 to resolve. With your encounters finished, it's now time to resolve the effects of the space that you moved your boat to. If you landed on a regular space, that is, one with a dot, and you have an empty space on your boat, you take 1 token from the lost and found pile and flip it face up. If it shows cargo, place that token anywhere in your boat. If it shows this found passenger artwork, instead remove this token from the game and take any 1 lost passenger from beside the board and put it into your boat. If there were no lost passengers to take, then you would just get nothing in that case. Also, don't forget every player has one of these skipper cards, which will have its own unique special ability that player can use. Pay attention to this because you might be able to take advantage of its abilities while you're playing. For example, when this player would be taking a lost and found token, instead they can just directly choose to take a lost passenger instead. If after a move your travels took you to an outpost, first you refresh your warning flare, flipping it back over if it was face down. Now it can be used again on a future turn. Then, if you have an empty space on your boat, you can either take a lost passenger from beside the board, or you can look through the tokens here and pick any one that you like. But you must decide on one or the other before you look at the cargo pieces. If you ended your move on one of these clue spaces, then you get to secretly look at the underside of the token there. This will show one of the four different families in the game, and every passenger is part of one or more of the families, and each has its own color and symbol. For example, this symbol shows the Temple family. After you've looked at the clue, just make sure you put it back face down. At the end of the game, the final clue here at the headquarters will be revealed, and passengers belonging to its family will be worth more points if successfully delivered. So the other clues you uncover along the way are really informing you of which families will not score you extra points. This might help you make important decisions about which passengers you keep on your boat. The catch is that getting to clue tokens often requires you to take the longer path, so you'll have to decide how valuable that information is to you. Also, if you know other players have already peeked at some clues, you might be able to get a sense of what they learned by paying attention to which passengers they start to get rid of and which ones they keep. Now, one thing I should mention is that you can never have more than 12 tokens on your boat at a time, and you can't voluntarily kick cargo or people overboard. If you would ever be required to add another token and you have no space, you just don't take anything. All right, so now we know how to take a turn. First, you may rearrange your boat, then you roll the die and move, reveal and resolve navigation cards, and then resolve the space you landed on. And turns will continue like this with players traveling towards the headquarters. As soon as a player gets here to the finish line, they take the highest valued tip token available, and for the rest of the game, any player already at the headquarters will no longer take a normal turn. Instead, on their turn, they just take another tip token. These will be worth points at the end of the game, so it rewards you for getting to the headquarters early. If all of the players end up on the final space together, then they will just take turns collecting these tokens back and forth until they're all gone. Once the last tip token has been collected, the game ends immediately. Any boats that were not already at the headquarters at that time are just picked up and moved directly there. They don't roll dice or resolve cards or other spaces. Then the clue token here is flipped face up so you can see which family has been chosen as the new caretakers of the company, and then you go to final scoring. Every regular passenger on your boat is worth 3 points, while each passenger that shows at least one symbol from the caretaker family is worth 5 points each. So here, each of these passengers are worth 3 points each, and these two are worth 5 each. Then you should organize your cargo so you have as many unique sets of 3 cargo as possible. Each of these sets are worth 10 points. Leftover pairs of 2 different types of cargo are worth 4 points, and any leftover single types of cargo are worth 1 point. Finally, each tip token you have is worth the number of points printed on them. And the player with the most points wins. In the case of a tie, the tied player with the most passengers wins. And if there's still a tie, the tied players share the victory. And that's how you play the Disney Jungle Cruise Adventure Game. If you have any questions about anything you saw here, feel free to put them in the comments below, and I'll gladly answer them as soon as I get a chance. You'll also find forums for discussion, pictures, other videos, and lots more over on the games page at Board Game Geek, and I'll put a link to that in the description below. And if you found this video helpful, please consider giving it a like, subscribing, and clicking that little bell icon so you get notification anytime we post a new video. But until next time, thanks for watching.